Imagine you're at the mall, ready to snag those epic headphones you've been eyeing. But shocker, the price just doubled. Ouch! Do you still buy them, or do you bail? Or what if your go-to jeans are suddenly half off? Do you grab twice as many pairs as usual, or not? How you react, my friends, depends on something we call price elasticity. Hey there, it's me, Bea. In today's lesson, we are going to take a deeper look into elasticity. By the end of the lesson, you should be able to answer the following. What is elasticity in terms of demand and supply? What factors influence elasticity of demand? What factors influence elasticity of supply? What are the implications of price elasticity? And you should start to think about our big picture question. How can understanding elasticity help us make better decisions? The word elastic, you probably picture a rubber band. You can stretch it in any direction, and as long as you don't stretch it too far, it will pop back into its original shape once you let go. Well, demand and supply can be just like that rubber band, sometimes at least. And the thing that makes it stretch or contract? Price changes. Okay, we already knew that price changes can change quantity demanded or supplied, but economists like to measure just how much those quantities change in response to prices. Economists call this elasticity. That's the impact of change in price on the quantity supplied or quantity demanded of a good or service. The more the quantity changes, the more elastic demand or supply is for that product. It stretches. The less the quantity changes in response to price changes, the less elastic demand or supply is. Economists call that inelastic. Okay, let's take a minute to check in by examining a specific good. Consider the smartphone. There are numerous brands and models, each with various features, quality levels, and price points. In other words, lots of options for consumers. And producers? They can ramp production up or down relatively quickly. How would you describe supply and demand elasticity for the smartphone market? So, what causes goods or services to be elastic or inelastic in demand or supply? Let's start by looking at demand. If you open up your PDF, you'll find two graphic organizers to help you take notes about the factors that influence elasticity. First off, we have the availability of substitutes. Maybe you've used substitutes in cooking or baking before. If you are out of eggs, you can use a banana instead. It's not exactly the same, but it works well enough to get the job done. If a good or service has substitutes, then consumers have other options if the price goes up. What do you think that means for demand elasticity? That's right! Goods and services with lots of substitutes generally have elastic demand. If the price goes up, they will simply buy a substitute instead. Next, we have compliments. No, not that kind of compliment. You looked at compliments in an earlier lesson. They are related goods that go together, like peanut butter and jelly, for example. What happens to the demand for jelly if the price of peanut butter goes way up? It will probably go down. We call this effect cross-elasticity, when the price of one good or service affects the demand for another. Another factor that can affect elasticity is the necessity of the good or service. Simply put, some things are more necessary than others. There are some things you cannot live without: food, housing, clothes, and medicine if you're sick. These are necessities. So what happens to demand for these goods if the price increases? Think about the foods you eat every week, for example. Let's say you buy a gallon of milk every week. You will probably continue to buy a gallon even if the price goes up by 10%, 20%, or even 30%. It would take a really big increase in price before you might consider changing your buying habits for milk. What if the price decreased? Would you suddenly start buying twice as much milk? Well, probably not. What would you do with all that extra milk? Your demand is not likely to change much with any change in price, either up or down. These necessary goods and services definitely have inelastic demand. Luxury goods, on the other hand, tend to have more elastic demand. You don't really need them. Take an expensive pair of shoes, for example. You might save up and splurge once or twice on an amazing pair of sneakers for $200. That'd be sweet. Now, if the price increased to $500, you could easily skip it. But whoa, if the price was knocked down to 50 bucks a pair? Oh yeah, you'd be heading down to the store to buy a few pairs. Gifts for everyone. That's elastic demand, all right. Now let's take a few minutes to think of some more examples of each of these factors to complete your graphic organizer. Now that we've identified some of the factors that affect demand elasticity, let's take a few minutes to talk about the factors that affect supply elasticity. Production time is a big factor. Some goods and services are quicker and easier to produce. For example, books and clothes are relatively simple and fast to produce. So those jeans you were looking to buy? Those would have high supply elasticity. The company could make more pretty quickly if the price increased. Another consideration is the availability of resources. You could have the most efficient way of making jeans, but if you can't easily get more cotton or dye, then you can't quickly produce more jeans. The more quickly and easily you can obtain the necessary resources, the more elastic your supply can be. Finally, the durability of goods can also affect the elasticity of supply. Durable goods, or those that do not wear out quickly and last over a longer period, have a more elastic supply. Why? Because they can be stored for a long time without losing their value. But what about things that don't last, like fresh strawberries or the newest iPhone? They can't suddenly be made overnight, and they spoil or become outdated pretty fast. So perishable goods have a more inelastic supply. Okay. Take a few minutes to think of some more examples of each of these factors to complete the graphic organizer on supply elasticity. So, why does all of this even matter? Well, price elasticity isn't just something for econ geeks. It impacts businesses, governments, and even you and me every single day. Let's see how. First, businesses. Ever notice how sometimes stores have sales with huge discounts and other times only a measly 10% off? That's because businesses use their understanding of price elasticity to set prices and discounts. If they know their product has elastic demand, they might lower price to increase sales. But if the demand is inelastic, like for a rare flavor of soda, they might not drop prices as much because they know you'll still buy it anyway. What about the consumers? You know, you and me. Understanding price elasticity can help us predict changes in the cost of goods and services. For example, if a consumer knows that demand for air travel is elastic, they could guess that airlines will offer discounted prices during off-peak seasons when demand is lower. They can plan their travel or large purchases accordingly to take advantage of these price drops. Okay. Take a few minutes to think of how you might or might not change your buying behavior depending on the elasticity of a good. Consider the following goods and services: gasoline, designer clothing, and avocados. Now, let's recap what we've learned about elasticity. Just like a rubber band, the quantity demanded and supplied can stretch and change depending on the price of a good or service. The elasticity of demand is affected by the availability of substitutes, the existence of complements, and the necessity of the good or service. The elasticity of supply is affected by the production time, availability of resources, and durability of the good or service. Both businesses and consumers can benefit from understanding the elasticity of supply and demand. Businesses can plan more effectively and make the best decisions on pricing. Consumers can make informed decisions and budget to best meet their wants and needs. Tomorrow, we're going to learn about market equilibrium and how supply and demand work together in a market economy. And remember, keep investing in yourself one lesson at a time. See you next time.